I'm kind of curious about the executive order and the origins of that, because this bill borrows, you know, maybe 75% of the language from that executive order, at least the general idea. So some background on how that came about would be interesting to me.
Sure. Yeah, I'll take that one. So as I mentioned at the beginning, I did a series of investigative reports on critical race theory in federal agencies. So for one example, they took the nuclear weapons engineers at Sandia National Labs. It took them white male engineers to a 3-day white male re-education retreat. They told them that they had to deconstruct their white male culture, that it was synonymous with the KKK and lynchings and slave owning and other historical injustices. Then they had to renounce their own white male Christian identity and then write letters of apology to women and people of color. I broke a number of stories like that. They were doing intersectionality training at the FBI. The Treasury Department denounced the United States as a fundamentally racist country, et cetera, et cetera. And I did an opening monologue, a joint monologue with Tucker Carlson. The president saw it, responded to the call, had his chief of staff call me the next day, and their White House put together the executive order in about 3 weeks, because I had laid out a case of all these stories from a dozen federal agencies. I've now done it in more than a dozen school districts, showing exactly what this ideology does to divide people, to assign guilt based on race, and truly to create a toxic working environment and opposing the institutions of this country. So they took it on, and frankly, they had the courage to do it. And I'd like to tell everyone on this call, it's gonna take courage to do this, but it's the right thing to do, and it's gonna be a popular thing to do. And you know, I don't think other administrations would have tackled this issue. I'm really glad that you're tackling it. You're gonna take some heat for it, but the more that you can educate your constituents on what it prevents, all it does, it prevents racial stereotyping, scapegoating, and discrimination. It prevents the Klan from doing it. It also prevents the CRT advocates from doing it. It's gonna take courage, and I just, I hope that you guys can summon that courage and that steely resolve, just like the folks in the White House, and get this thing done.
Yeah, just to add real quick to that, I just want to emphasize the point that Chris just made, because I think everyone that fights back against this ideology, we all pay a price for fighting back against it, but we do it because it is the absolute right thing to do. If you ever had any questions about what you would have done in Germany leading up to the Holocaust, or what you would have done during the civil rights movement, what you are doing right now is the answer to that question. This is an existential threat to this country, and this is not even a left or right issue. This is about doing what is right and having the courage of your convictions to stand up for it. And if you guys do, you will receive so much support you cannot imagine.
Keith, if I could just add something to that.
Sure.
This is a very key point. This is not a left or right issue. We have many people on the left, like Glenn Greenwald, like Barry Weiss, like Andrew Sullivan, Steven Pinker, with whom I disagree at Harvard on many, many, many things. But he likes liberal democracy, and he understands that we need to stand up for liberal democracy. And right. He understands that to tell a black child
the classic definition of liberal, right?
Right. And these people on the left understand that to tell a black child that it is a white thing to love to read and write, that it is a white thing to work hard, that it is a white thing to be punctual, it's a form of child abuse.
Right.
So this is not, again, I think Carlin put it exactly right. This is not a left or right thing.